A very good morning, church, and to all of those of y'all at home watching us online, a very good morning to each one of y'all. As we start today's service, let us come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you for this brand new day. We thank you, Lord, that your mercies are new every morning and great is your faithfulness. And so, Father, we want to commit this service into your hands, and we commit ourselves into your hands, Lord, and those at home too. We pray, Lord, that this morning, Holy Spirit, we invite you to be here. We ask, Lord, take over now as we surrender our hearts and our minds to you. Father, we pray, help us lay all our troubles, our concerns at the foot of the cross right now and just be sold out to hear what the Spirit wants to say to each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can I ask, invite you all to stand as we start with the opening song? He is Exalted by our dear brother Daniel. Will be up on the screen.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Rejoicing his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. And he is exalted, the King is exalted on high. How wonderful, how beautiful, name above every name, exalted high. How wonderful, how beautiful, Jesus, your name, name above every name, Jesus. above every name, exalted high. How wonderful, how beautiful, Jesus, your name above every name. How wonderful, how wonderful, how beautiful, name above every, exalted high. How wonderful, how beautiful, Jesus, your holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high.
We indeed, Lord, you are a beautiful Savior. You are a glorious King. And Lord, we cannot help, Lord, but just look to you always because you are faithful. And so, Father, we just want to give thanks, Lord, for all that you've done for us and for all that you're going to do for us. Oh, Holy Spirit, again, we ask, come. Come and fill this place, and not only this place, Lord, but for our brothers and sisters at home too, that they will feel you, Lord. Oh, we commit, Lord, our lives to you afresh this morning. Thank you, Lord, for loving us unconditionally. For truly, Lord, you are faithful and merciful. And so, Father, we come before you now, Lord, as a family of God, dearly beloved in our Father's presence, to offer him our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. Brothers and sisters, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I'd like to encourage you to either kneel or sit as we come before the Lord, just ourselves and the Lord, to confess and repent of our sins. I'd like us to just take a minute on our own as we come before the Lord. Brothers and sisters, let us confess our sins to the Almighty God. Together we pray, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Would you receive God's grace and his forgiveness? May Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Continuing in a prayer of posture, let us pray the collect for today, the third Sunday before Advent. Together we pray. Almighty God, whose chosen servant Abraham faithfully obeyed your call and rejoiced in your promise that in him all the families of the earth should be blessed, give us a faith like his, that in us your promises may be fulfilled through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We will now have the first reading. Please be seated for the first reading as I call upon Lyra.
The first reading is taken from the Old Testament, the book of Ezekiel, chapter 34, verses 7 to 10. Ezekiel 34, verses 7 to 10. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, declares the Lord God, surely because my sheep have become a prey, and my sheep have become food for all the wild beasts, since there was no shepherd, and because my shepherds have not searched for my sheep, but the shepherds have fed themselves, and have not fed my sheep. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against the shepherds, and I will require my sheep at their hand, and put a stop to their feeding the sheep. No longer shall the shepherds feed themselves. I will rescue my sheep from their mouths, that they may not be food for them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 9, beginning at verse 35. Glory to Christ our Savior. Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 to 38. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord. Friends, would you please be seated? This morning, we have someone who I believe many of you are familiar with him, because this is where he grew up. And in fact, this is where he, together with his wife Gwen, who is here, they got married here in St. Paul's. So I believe their presence here has brought back many memories of the times in which God has formed them spiritually. And for Reverend Stephen, we know each other quite well, because we serve together in All Saints Church, and God has called him into full-time ministry, and he's presently the Dean of Cambodia. And so as I was thinking of who to come during our Missions Month to share with us God's Word, he came to my mind, and I'm thankful that he was able to come and to bring to us God's Word. Just to tell you about missions for St. Paul's, St. Paul's Church is not just a singing church. That's what I was told when I came, you know. St. Paul's Church is a singing church. You've got the choir and all that. But St. Paul's Church is a missional church. It's history. As I read the history of St. Paul's Church, it's a church that has been sending out and continues to send out workers into the harvest field, and also to call a people to bless the community. And so with regards to Cambodia, We have Sheila David, who has served many years in Cambodia, has a missionary, has a sent one from St. Paul's Church. We also, in the past, have been doing work in Cambodia in a place called Rokakos, where the church has, where St. Paul's Church has actually contributed towards a church building there. Having come on board last year as the vicar, in reigniting our missions, we focus very much on Pai, right? So Thailand, you hear a lot about the work in Pai. But we will, over time, so I've told the dean to give us some time to get the congregation on board and to grow spiritually, because missions flows out of our worship. Yeah. So with that as a background, would you join me to warmly welcome Reverend Stephen as he brings God's word to us?
Thank you, Reverend Jeremy, for that really kind introduction. I'm really delighted that your vicar invited me to speak here today. I cannot tell you the joy I feel in being with you this morning. You see, I was baptized, confirmed, and married in St. Paul's Church in the 1980s. You know, can you imagine that long ago? It was in here, in the old church building, that I received my call to full-time ministry. An elderly American missionary couple gave me that word. You know, after service, they were the guest speakers. So, you know, St. Paul's Church is where I began my faith journey. So it's such a wonderful feeling to be back this morning. I'm here to share about my call to be a long-term missionary to Cambodia and to tell you a little bit about the work of the Anglican Church there, and hopefully to give us all a word for this morning. So before we hear God's word, can we go to God in prayer? Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Father, Lord, may your Spirit open our minds and our hearts to hear, to understand, and to receive. Yeah, give us ears and minds to understand, and a heart to obey. We pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen. So my first point is about my call to Cambodia. You know, I answered the call to full-time 17 years after receiving the call. And when I did, I went to Bible school for 3 years. I went back to All Saints Church. I served as a youth pastor. That was in 2006. I got ordained as a deacon in 2007, priesthood in 2008, and 1.5 months later, I moved to Chapel of Christ the King, where I spent 8 years, 6 of which I was the vicar of the parish. And then I got involved in Cambodia in 2009, when Chapel of Christ the King sent 2 of our members to be missionary teachers there. So I didn't know anything about the Anglican work in Cambodia. I asked a lot of questions. Guess what? I ended up being the home base coordinator. I replaced Reverend Paul Tan. Okay. Anyway, that was something I was glad to do because I thought that would put me in a better position to care for my 2 missionaries. I would make 3 to 4 trips a year, each lasting usually 5 days. And in 2014 and 2015, that stretched over 9 days so that I could be there on 2 Sundays to preach and to celebrate. Yeah, my time was usually spent holding council meetings, staff meetings, sorting out finances and taxes. And I do a little bit of training, visit people or agency that might be of help to the work there. In 2011, I was made associate dean. But by 2015, I was starting to consider pulling out of the deanery of Cambodia. I just didn't think I was contributing to the deanery with what I was doing. And I want to let you know, I felt no call at that time to be a missionary at all. On the contrary, I was on the brink of leaving the work there, I didn't want to do that. But strangely, in 2015, that year, I received my call to go to Cambodia for the long haul. You see, I was teaching the epistles of Paul for DCBS, Diocesan Certificate of Biblical Studies, and then it struck me that Paul, the Apostle Paul, was very pastoral at heart. You know, I knew him to be an excellent missionary with a brilliant theological mind, but pastoral at heart. And that spoke to me. That really hit me hard. You see, we were bosses. We were paymasters. We were professors. We were managing things far away via email and then trying to download on these people whatever knowledge we had, you know. But we were not shepherds to them. We were not shepherds to these flocks, nor were we relationally close to them. How could we? We pop in now and then. We don't speak their language. And whenever we meet, we talk shop nearly all the time. Wow. We cared. We genuinely cared about their welfare. We make sure they get a good pay, real benefits, and so on and so forth. But we were hardly around. We were not present to them. You see, but that's exactly what they needed. Then when I was teaching this course, poor pastoral at heart, I look at the people in Cambodia, and this came to me. They were like sheep without a shepherd. Whew. Matthew 9. Let me say, the diocese was trying her best, but the diocese was constrained by the myriad demands placed on the clergy. There was just no able and willing candidate at that time, clergyman to send to Cambodia to be their shepherd. And guess what? God put that burden in my heart to be that shepherd. Yeah. So, because we were starting a major reconstruction of the new building, other church, main church building in Phnom Penh, Bishop Rennes wanted me to spend half a month in Singapore, half a month in Cambodia from 2016 onwards until the project's completion. Well, I told him I had a better offer for him. I told him I was willing to be based full-time in Phnom Penh, but not until the project's completion, but until the gospel is preached to all of Cambodia, or until I retire. Bishop Rennes took my offer. So on November 10, 2016, Gwen and I stepped foot into Phnom Penh as long-term missionaries. God, I want to tell you this, God paved the way. An amenable bishop, an agreeable parish, a wonderfully supportive and gifted wife, care for my elderly mother and grown-up children. God made it all possible. Okay, that's the first question in your bulletin. Okay. All right. Now I want to talk a little bit about the work in Cambodia. Of course, you all maybe know this already. Because the work began in 1993 with Reverend Don Cormack. Reverend Mok and his late wife, Miwa, succeeded Reverend Don Cormack in 1997 and served until 2007. But so from 2008 to 2016, there was no Singapore priest based in Phnom Penh. Reverend Tit Hien, our first Cambodian priest, he helmed the work during that period with supervision or support from Singapore until my posting in November 2016. When the deanery started in 1993, we had just one church in Phnom Penh City with primarily an expat congregation and a few Cambodian believers. By 2016, the work has grown from the city church to include Chinese church, church extension in Tak Mau and Rokakor, a work, as your vicar said, started by St. Paul's when Reverend Mok was vicar here. Churches in four provinces serve each serving multiple small groups. So in 2018, the old villa, our church in Phnom Penh, became a seven-story city church. And then an old hut in Tak Mau became a new church. And then St. Hilda's supported a four-story learning center in Swai Rin. That was completed. Now, since moving into the new church building in Phnom Penh City, attendances in the English and Khmer congregations grew. And then actually, in October 2019, we actually started a Chinese service to serve the multitudes of PRCs that were coming into Cambodia. There were, in Cambodia alone, there were like easily 200,000 of them at that time. So it was that. Then we had two learning centers. We had dorm. Did I get that? A daycare center. We did dorm ministry. We did children ministry in two villages. And then, of course, we had the Singapore teams coming over to run various programs. So we have Alpha, sports, and language classes. We teach English, Chinese, Khmer, run Alpha. run sport ministry to build bridges with the community. Singapore teams came over to run vacation Bible school, children, youth camp, evangelistic rallies, and then to do medical and dental missions. So I want to look at some photographs with you. Can we see the photograph? This is the photograph of the two new church buildings. The one on my right is Takmal. The old hut was termite infested, so we had to get a new one, so we built a new nice church. And then look at that new building. This is a picture of the consecration. It's a seven-story building from the old villa we had. This is a really decent picture of the villa, because by the time we did reconstruction, the roof was about to fall on us. It was flooding. It was leaking. It was like cracks everywhere. Next picture, please. Okay, this is the learning center. I just want to show you what an investment that St. Hilda's has put. It's a four-story building. So one on the left is the picture of the class. In the middle is a picture of the children and youth camp they run. So when they do run in that area, we get hundreds of people coming. Next slide, please. This is learning center in Takmal. I have to show this because my wife runs this work there. So you can see her in a motorbike. All the kids love her. Our teachers are there. She's so creative. We have all these apps to learn English on phones, on computers, so that the kids can learn at their own pace. So this is just the work that she did there. And Gwen wanted to share this story. I wanted to give her time, but she didn't. I don't think we have time for her to share. But Gwen shared with me, there's a 15-year-old boy who is quiet, good boy. And then he was teaching, his name is Vin Long. Vin Long had to take himself out of school to go to the factory to work for the family. But Vin Long died. He died of either a kidney or a pancreatic disease. All right? So Gwen's point is, you know, we never know how much time we have with the kids. Because the parents, they come, they pull the kid out of school because we are Christian. They pull the kids out to look after their siblings. They pull the kids out to do all sorts of things. So the time we have with the children is really unpredictable. So this is the work in Takmal. Next slide, please. I think there's one more. I need to share this. This is a training institution. It's called Project Khmer Hope, run entirely by St. Andrew's Cathedral. I'm not doing anything with it. Deaconess Bessie Lee is leading this work. So they provide hospitality training for the poor and needy youth, initially in Kampong Speu, and later now is to all the provinces. And then they teach them English in the first year, then train them in hospitality skills. So you see in the middle, there's a little bit of serving there. Susan Ong is the center executive, a former senior SIA cabin crew, you know, cabin chief. So she is such a wonderful leader. She said she would give 2 years of her life to this work. She's now in her 12th year. It's funny how God works and how the work actually touches you. Okay, so that's Susan. So at the bottom, you see the picture of the center. It's a really wonderfully built center. Since their inception, we receive maybe between 40 to 80 students every year for baptism. That's how good it is. So many of them have been able to find work in the city and then provide for their family. Susan loves to tell a story about this boy whose name I cannot remember. He managed to find work actually on a cruise ship. But 3 years later, he earned enough money to come back to buy land and to build a home for his parents. He comes back to the center and thanks Susan. They all see her like the mother. And some of them actually, they are general manager or managers in hotels in Phnom Penh City. One of them is apparently the best bartender in Phnom Penh. Okay, so it's making a huge difference in the life of the people there. Okay, I now come back to this. This is the wonderful work that St. Andrew's Cathedral. Brothers and sisters, that's like a very quick overview of what we were before COVID-19. Obviously, no more trips by the Singapore teams. Things are slowly gearing back up. Today, my assessment is we're probably past the 50% mark of what we were doing before. I want to talk about one more highlight, Rokako. Your vicar said it's a work. So this is the picture. You see Mark and Liz, they are Irishmen, you know, all the way from Europe. And they have a burden for underprivileged children. They are God's answer to my prayer. Because I was looking for leaders to head or any work. I don't care what the work is, any work for this place that we have in Rokako. Monday to Friday, the place was unused. So they were unanswered. So they founded an NGO called Eggshell. So in this place, they provide a safe place with routine, nutrition, Bible stories and songs. The kids, they come initially, maybe not used to it, some traumatized, some really very malnourished. They flourish in this center. And not only do the children flourish, because the children are in the center, the parents or the grandparents who were looking after them, they were free to look for work in nearby factories. And that helped the economic well-being of those families. So, some good news. There was a former staff. Her name, I cannot remember, starts with M. But anyway, M comes from a very staunch Buddhist family. She watched Liz and listened to all these Bible stories. 2 years ago at a Christmas outreach, the sister accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. Praise the Lord. Serious girl, good girl, accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. In July this year, we're giving out food to the poor because of COVID. We invited the village chief to come. The plan was let the village chief say something, then the staff would preach the gospel. So when the village chief finished saying what he had to say, Mark went to the staff, okay, time for the gospel. Mark, no need, sir. No need to preach the gospel anymore. Because the village chief just did. Just told the people, you come and believe in Jesus. Look at what these people are doing. Wonderful, wonderful work. Brothers and sisters, this center is now maxed up. With the staff and the space they have with 10 children. Okay, this is a work that Mark is hoping to expand. They are unable, they have a long queue. Okay, people approach them, can you take in my children? They have a long queue, but they're unable to take them in. It is a work, in my opinion, in my assessment, worth expanding. Can I have the picture of the thing? All right. So this is the land and the building that you all paid for. So the yellow part, we could just expand it by building something in front, or we could expand that and then buy the plot of land that is available at the back, which is the red mark area. So guys, the posture that Mark has is wonderful. He will build as God provides. He recognizes this is COVID season, funds may not be there, but he will build as God's provide. No preconceived scale, no preconceived timeline. As the Lord enables, and I pray that God will enable this work to expand. Sorry, I'm rushing. I got 10 more minutes. Next one, the word for the mission, the word of God for us this morning. Brothers and sisters, I changed the title of my sermon. It was actually a shepherd for the flock. I changed it to not sheep without a shepherd. Okay, not sheep without a shepherd. So the main idea is that God does not want any one of us to be without a shepherd. So I start with Ezekiel 34. Ezekiel 34 tells us that God himself will be the shepherd of Israel. Why? Because the shepherd of his people, the Israelites. Why? Because the shepherd of Israel did not. They did not shepherd these people. And Jesus came to be the great shepherd of the sheep. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20. Matthew 9 then tells us, the passage we just read, tells us to pray to God to send workers to his harvest field. To his harvest field. Okay? When he saw that the crowds were harassed, helpless, like sheep without a shepherd, he doesn't want that to happen. He's sending us. But I want you to see that it was always God's plan that the great shepherd would have his under-shepherds. So, you know, after that prayer, he sent out the 70. Okay? Then the next one is, what is the role of the under-shepherd? I think about this conversation that Jesus had with Peter in John 21. Feed my lamb. Take care of my sheep. We're supposed to feed and take care of the sheep. And then I go, then there's something I want you to pick. If you look at Matthew chapter 9, Jesus preached in the synagogue everywhere he went. He preached in the synagogue to the Jews, to the people. So we're supposed to preach to you and make sure you grow in the faith. But Jesus was out in the hillside of Galilee to preach to the crowd, the Gentiles, the people were outside. So the role of the shepherd is both to take care of the people inside and also to take care of those that are outside. I come back to Ezekiel 34 because Ezekiel 34 speaks to me. When the under-shepherd fails to feed and care for the sheep, when they lead them away from God to other idols, and when they oppress them for personal gain, God will call them to account. right? They have to account before God. And then for me, the worst thing is, actually the more terrible thing is that the sheep has to pay a heavy price because they are neglected, because they are abused, they may lose their salvation, they may lose the love that God wants to show to each one of them. Brothers and sisters, I'm encouraged by the word today to move in two directions that I'm minded to take for Cambodia, but I'm also challenged in three areas. Whew. Okay, I got five more minutes, one more page. Should be able to do it. Okay, the first one is moving out of our comfort zone. Since I got involved in Cambodia, the Anglican Church in Phnom Penh has been doing work in Phnom Penh plus four provinces. And that's been like more than a decade. It's about a decade. But before that, we've been doing this amount of work. Cambodia has 25 provinces. We are only in four of them. It's time for us to move out of our comfort zone, to go to places where the Anglican Church has no work or presence, to go to the other 21 provinces. I figure, just mathematically, if we reach out to 2 to 3 provinces a year, in maybe 7 to 11 years, we'll reach out to the rest. About time I retire, 11 years, if I get extended by the bishop at that time. Okay, so remember, not just the synagogue, not just keep doing what you're doing in the work that you have. Jesus went to the hillside of Galilee to preach, so we need to go out of what we have. So that's one thing. The harvest is plentiful in Cambodia. Population 16.5 million, only 2 to 3% Christians. More than 15 million Cambodians have not accepted Christ. I don't have the data, I tried to look for it, for the number of churches from missionary in country. In any case, the definition of church is not the clearest. By church, I can be small group, no? 10 people, whatever. But so the estimate of the figures I've read range from 2,400 to 7,000. But I think if you count the small ones, maybe there are more. But the point is, still 90% of the Cambodians have not heard. Have not accepted Christ. Okay, the big takeaway is not enough workers, not enough churches. The work of proclaiming the gospel to everyone in Cambodia still has much to do. I heard a presentation. I attended a missions conference in the United States last September, I beg your pardon. I heard a presentation on Unreached People's Group. When I was in St. Paul's, I heard a presentation on Unreached People's Group. The contents, they were the same. But somehow, the video hit my heart. So there, I'm thinking to myself, yes, God, I will get the Anglican Church in Cambodia to pray for Unreached People's Group. Question popped into my mind. Then what about the unreached ones in Cambodia? Yeah. So it's not just praying, but it's us going to the unreached ones inside Cambodia. People and places where there is no Christian, where there is no church, where the name of Jesus is never uttered. That night, God laid that burden on my heart to reach out to these unreached people in Cambodia. You see, brothers and sisters, when we see humanity made in God's image, they are all God's people, isn't it? If they don't know Christ, they don't have the shepherd. So unreached people, they are definitely God's sheep without a shepherd. Then the next thing I'm thinking of doing is strengthening the shepherds. I have been thinking about how I can resource and train my rural pastors to preach 52 weeks a year. I struggle to do that. What about them? Okay, I got them Khmer Bible study. I gave them data cards so they can access Khmer Christian material. I trained them to do sermon outlines. Then what about the pastors outside the Anglican Church who have no help from anyone else? These pastors are all over Cambodia. You may need to travel hours just to reach them, especially the ones in the rural areas. What can we do? Ezekiel 34 is about shepherds who didn't care, shepherds who turned their flocks away from God. But what about shepherds who are untrained? If they are untrained, how can they feed the flock? How can they care for the flock? The idea is a very simple one, brothers and sisters. You feed the shepherds so you can feed the flock. Very simple. So strengthening them. I put that, you know, in the late 1800s, the first Catholic missionaries, when they reached Cambodia, top objective, let's set up a Bible school. That first Catholic missionary, I have to set up a Bible school to train local pastor. In the 1920s, the first Protestant missionaries that went there, it's a critical need to train the pastor, set up training school. Today, speaking just to an American missionary about 3-4 weeks ago, who has been training local pastor since he arrived in Cambodia in the late 1990s, it amazes him that he continues to meet so many untrained pastors. He did a survey in 2012. I studied the survey. Maybe 5% or less than 5% has a proper systematic theological training. Most attend 1-2 days, 3 days workshop of seminar, as and when they can. Can you just see? I mean, then I read the rest of the survey. The conclusion is very clear to me. Many of them are under-trained, under-resourced, and underpaid. Jeremy, another 2-3 more minutes. I'm almost there. Okay. So how can we expect them to shepherd their flock in God's word? Okay, this is a huge gap where the Anglican Church can do its bit to fill in. Just 2 weeks ago, I was told about a group of 30 pastors in Saan, about an hour's drive from Tak Mau Town. They are looking for training, each with an average of 10 to 20 members in their congregation. I've started to look for potential partners to provide that training. Feeding his sheep includes feeding those who are called to be shepherds so that they will not fail the sheep in their penfold, brothers and sisters, and they would not be found wanting in the final reckoning. I had three challenges. Love. Singaporeans, they love to train. We all like to go overseas and tell people how brilliant we are. But what the sheep needs more is relationship. What the pastor needs in terms of relationship is mentoring and spiritual friendship. And guys, this is exactly what God wants us to have with Him, relationship, and to have with each other. And you know what? Genuine care. Genuine care really happens only in relationship. But building relationship is a challenge for Singaporeans, for me. We are not naturally disposed to do that. You throw in language, cultural differences, then you need time to understand the differences, right? And then time we often cannot give or do not give. Also a challenge for the Cambodians themselves to build relationships. So where to find mentors? How to build relationship? Difficult, but still necessary. Still, it's what God wants. God wants for mission. Number two, second challenge is focusing on the right thing, on focusing on people rather than on ministry. You know, we are so conditioned to think efficiency, KPI, then we think about the activity, we think about how to do it better more than we think about the people themselves. So Gwen has a story to share. The day of the consecration service, our bishop is there, she's running up and down. You know, my wife is doing everything in the background so I can sit in the front pew and enjoy the aircon. Okay, wow. So I thank God for my wife. But this woman with a baby wrapped in a towel reeked with urine, a son that is naked, came and sat at the back of the church hall. She's like, I got so many things to do. But God put this in her head. Don't forget this woman. You know, consecration service, the woman matters. Okay, so we needed to care for that. I want to tell you another example. Singapore team leader said to the pastor in front of his team, "Hey, how many students will there be tomorrow?" Actually, nobody really knows how many will turn up. They turn up and then they turn up. We can give an estimate. Oh, we have to pack the welcome gift, and we have to do it tonight because tomorrow morning we're leaving straight after breakfast. You know, we need about 1.5-2 hours to do this. You know. So how many students? 100? 200? 300? Yeah, I wrote you email, you never reply. I'm glaring at him. He had put the activity of getting these welcome packs ready above the dignity of my pastor. I spoke to the head of the team. Please, this must never happen again. We must learn to focus on people above ministry, okay? We must move away from that, okay? Third challenge is how we give money. So I've been reading about these books. Apparently, 80 to 90% of charity money is wasted. Ben, I'm not talking about you. And never achieve their objectives, you know? And people don't do it. I think churches especially, we don't evaluate how the money is eventually spent, right? We don't. Then in the end, we end up hurting more than helping the donees or the recipients. We create dependency. We disempower them. I see this in the deanery of Cambodia. Yeah, our counterparts are waiting for Singapore to provide their money. They're not thinking of how they can raise money for ministry, for etc., you know, the things that they need. And then it's disempowering as they tend to do what the foreigner wants, and not what they think is right and good. Everything I go there, so pastor, what do you want? What do you think? I think I do what the pastor wants. I'm the patron. I'm the one with the line to the money in Singapore. So that's really disempowering. Yeah? Worse, some are like totally incapacitated. So give an example, the well, you know, it's clotted, it's blocked and all that, cannot use. They do nothing. They have to wait for the foreigner who will come, whether 1 year, 2 years later, to clean up and repair the well. Disempowering, brothers and sisters. We need to work hard. Me and you and all our parishes, we need to work hard and understand how to give money in a way that will truly help the donees and will not hurt them. So that was my third challenge. Wow, sounds so difficult, right? Mindful of all these challenges, brothers and sisters, is not reason for despair, even though I despair. But it is reason for us to submit and to depend even more on the great shepherd of the sheep. I leave you, or I'm encouraged, and so I leave you with these verses from the book of Hebrews. Look up there. I'm not going to read all that. I'm just going to summarize. Now may the God of peace equip you and I with everything good, beneficial, necessary for doing His will, and that may He work in us that which is pleasing to Him through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. All right, I exceeded my time by 5 minutes. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you, Reverend Stephen, for sharing the work that happens over there and all that God is doing with you and Gwen. Yeah. And so, brothers and sisters, after hearing the word being proclaimed and the sharing, let us affirm our faith. Can I ask you to stand as we affirm our faith in the Apostles' Creed? Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please kneel or sit as we go into a time of intercession by our sister Sheila.
Let us pray. Holy Spirit, rain down upon us. Come, Lord. Father, we want to thank you for your word. We want to thank you for what we have heard. God, I pray that you would stir in our hearts a desire to hear from you as to what you would want each one of us to do for your glory, for your name's sake. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, rain down. Lord, we want to thank you for this morning. We want to thank you for gathering us together. want to thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit that is at work even right now. We thank you that this church belongs to you. God, we want to pray for our bishop at this time, Bishop Titus Chung and his family. We ask that you'd continue to be with him and his wife and children. We pray that you would protect them, watch over them, give him all the wisdom he needs to lead the diocese in the ways of God. God, we want to thank you for St. Paul's Church. We thank you for Reverend Jeremy Yiping, our children. We pray for all of our pastors here who serve you, Lord, with so much of love and patience. I'm just reminded of 1 Thessalonians 5:12 to 18. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. God, I pray that you would just encourage all of our pastors and our leaders today. That, Lord, you would tell them that you are pleased with them, that you will honor them and their service for you. God, we want to pray for the upcoming PCC pastors' prayer and planning. It's coming up on the 14th of November. Lord, we want to pray that they will hear your voice. They will know exactly what you are telling them to do for this coming year in 2021. God, we pray for a spirit of unity and of wisdom. God, and when we seek you with all of our hearts, we are found of you. And that's such a beautiful promise, because we will be found of you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God, we want to thank you for the launch of the 7 visitation teams. God, there are many in our midst who are homebound, who are sick and suffering, and we thank you for those who willingly rose up to this occasion to visit them and to pray with them, to encourage them, to support them. So we pray, Lord, that your blessing will be upon the teams as they go out. You give them the words to say. You give them the power, Lord, that they will walk not in the flesh, but by the power of your Holy Spirit, that whatever they say, Lord, and whatever they do, that it will be a blessing to those who receive it. So we thank you, Lord, for these teams. God, we remember Winnie, and we ask that you would be with her at this time when she has lost Fong. I remember Fong serving you faithfully, Lord, in this church. He was always up there in the PA. And so, God, we pray that you would be with Winnie and her children. That, Lord, we thank you that Fong is with you. And we just pray for your peace and for your comfort, Lord, upon the family. We thank you also for the Sunday school that is going to resume on the 15th of November. We pray that parents will bring their children back to Sunday school. We pray, God, that the children will grow and learn in you, that they will be the future leaders of the church and of this community and of this nation. And we pray that you would bless them and that you would continue, Lord, to be with the teachers who tirelessly serve at the same time. So we are just so grateful to you, Lord, for this day and for bringing us together. And we pray that this church will continue to grow and that, Lord, you will send out people into missions. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Shall we stand together so we share the peace with one another? We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We share the peace with one another with non-touch gestures. You may sit or kneel as we continue in prayer, as we pray together the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. And give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
At all times I will bless Him. Praise will be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. The humble man will hear of Him. Afflicted will be glad and join with me to magnify the Lord. Let us exalt His name together forever. I sought the Lord, He heard me and delivered me from my fears. Let us
church and those at home. Just have two announcements this morning. The first one that we like to highlight to you is a bookmarks sale happening on the 15th and the 22nd of November. That will be happening next Sunday and the following Sunday. Let us just show a short preview video of what I'm talking about. Hi everyone, Pastor Leon here, and I trust that each one of you are safe and well. Just wanted to share with you two events that we'll be having on the 15th and on the 22nd of November in church, just before the service proper, and which is our promotion of our SPC bookmarks. Yeah, if you all can recall, early on this year, we had a lovely donation from one of our members who actually designed and printed and gave these over to the church. And so we're actually going to put these bookmarks on sale at $5 a set. And these bookmarks actually indicate the five different pillars that we have adopted for St. Paul's Church. And on the back of the bookmarks, you will see that each of them have our vision statement there. And of course, we also have the timing of our different services. And way below are the contact numbers,
Facebook page and Instagram page for St. Paul's Church. Now, we are actually we want to encourage you to actually contribute by purchasing these bookmarks, and your contribution will go to the SBC Missions Fund. And so it's $5 a set, and I think it's also a pretty good evangelistic tool where you can actually use it to do outreach. For example, maybe you want to give one bookmark to a friend or a family member whom you've been praying for. Or maybe you want to give them the whole set of five. It's really up to you. But I think it's a great talking point, a great tool for outreach, where you can actually use it and talk about your faith and even your testimony. So yeah, so we want to encourage you to bring cash on that day, on the 15th and 22nd of November. Just before service, we're going to set up two tables, one in Zone A, one in Zone B, and we will have people manning and looking forward to receiving you as you come into church. And so I do hope you will contribute to the SBC Missions Fund. We thank you for all your prayers and your support all these years. And so we look forward for the 15th and the 22nd where you will come around. Now, just in case you can't make it on 15th and the 22nd, don't worry. The bookmarks are also available for sale in the church office. All you need to do is either contact me or any of the staff, and we'll be more than glad to help you out. So thank you once again, brothers and sisters. Each of you take care, God bless, stay safe, and we will see you real soon. Goodbye.
Okay, so 15th and 22nd of November, right here before service starts, we'll have two tables, all right, on Zone A and Zone B, and you can actually purchase this bookmarks at $5 a set. Now, of course, if you feel led to contribute more, by all means, all right? So just to let you know, on the 15th and 22nd of November, 8:45 a.m. before the service, all right, here, we will have the sale, okay? So that's the first announcement. The second announcement is the birthday of the King. Now, we want you to mark down the date again, all right, Saturday, 19th of December in your schedule, and plan now for a small gathering at your home and invite 5 or 8 people, that's if MOH guidelines change, all right, at least 5 people to your home. You can even be among your cell group members, yeah? So gather at about 5 p.m. at home, all right? Tune in for the streaming, which will happen at 6 p.m. through our YouTube channel. And of course, have some food. Food is always welcome, yeah, at small group gatherings. Have some food, and you can have the food after the program. And what we'd like you to also do is try to get a little birthday cake, all right, for your group, all right? And once, program is over, you can all stand together. You can even sing a song, yeah, if you like to, and cut the cake. And of course, please take a photograph of the group and post it to us, send it to us in the church office, and we can post it up. Now, for whatever reasons, if you cannot host a gathering at home, all right, you can always coordinate among yourselves with your other friends from the other cell groups, all right, to join their group. And if you really, really cannot, okay, you can always contact me and let me know, all right, if you have any difficulty. That's one. Number two, all those homes who are planning to open their homes, please get in touch with me so that I can know where you guys are at, and so I can actually have the information ready so that I can help spread the word to the rest of our members in the church. And last but not least, do spread the news about this event. Now remember, every time Christmas is celebrated, we always look forward to receiving gifts. But this time around, we want to do something different. We ask you, we ask ourselves, what can we give back to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords on the Christmas day? Yeah, so that's something that we want you all to be prepared for. And I just want to show you a very short video that we put together, the youth put together. It's something like this, okay? We're going to build up on the whole program towards the 19th. So this is just a first teaser. Hey, hi Silas. Okay, come. Come Silas, let's have a seat. All right. Yeah. So, basically, this is something we want you to use for your imagination of you inviting your friends over to your homes. This is what it's going to look like. So, that's all the announcements I have. Over to you, Vicar.
Thank you, Leon. Yeah, today we really thank God for Reverend Stephen and for Gwen for being with us and also for bringing God's word. Can we just show them our appreciation? Yeah. They're both heading back to Cambodia, targeted to go back second week of December. So I thought it'd be important for us to pray for them. After all, as we know from his testimony, formed in St. Paul's and really the church that has formed him and sent him to be a blessing to the church in Cambodia. So we do want to pray for them. If I can ask them to come up, and then we can pray for you. I'll ask Georgie, Vicar's warden, to commit them to the Lord in prayer, praying for safety. They have three children, so the three children are here in Singapore. And it's just a tremendous sacrifice and commitment to be a channel of blessing to the people in Cambodia. So if you can stretch out your hands to them as we commit them to the Lord.
Let's stretch out our hands as we commit our brother Stephen and sister Gwen to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for both your servants, Stephen and Gwen, Father, whom you have called way back, Lord, in the time when they were here in St. Paul's, Lord, into full-time ministry, Lord, and whom you have called, Lord, as a worker in your harvest field in Cambodia in 21:5, Lord. Lord, to go out and to reach out to your people in Cambodia, Father. And your word goes forth, Lord, which says, be strong and of good courage, for you will go with them and with them, Lord, into Cambodia, Father. And we thank you, Lord, for the many fruits, Lord, of their ministry, Lord, during this many years, Lord, of 4 or 5 years in Cambodia, Lord, to build up, Lord, your kingdom, Father. And Lord, indeed, the fields are ripe unto harvest, Lord, and that, Lord, indeed, you have sent them out as workers into your harvest field in Cambodia, Father. And indeed, Lord, there are many provinces that are still to hear of your word in Cambodia, Father. So, Lord, as they return back in obedience to your call, Lord, in this next coming 2 weeks or so, Father, Lord, you go before them and with them, Lord, because you know what lies ahead, Father. Lord, that your word still holds true, be strong and of good courage, for you will never leave them nor forsake them, Father. And we just pray, O God, that as they go, Father, that, Lord, you anoint them afresh with the power of your Holy Spirit, O Sharabakara Sheba, that, Lord, indeed, Father, Lord, they will go in your strength, Lord. They will go with that confidence, Lord, and that courage. You will go, Lord, with your peace, Lord, in their hearts, Lord, to know, Father, that, Lord, you have already gone before them and with them. That, Lord, indeed, Father, even in these times of COVID-19, Father, we just ask for your protection over them, Father. That, Lord, indeed, you place your angels around them, Father. Lord, as they go in obedience to your call, Father. Lord, so we want to thank you and praise you. We pray that, Lord, you grant them journey mercies there, Father. You grant them, Lord, peace and strength, O God, Lord, and wisdom, Father, Lord, to know your plans ahead, Lord, as your worker in the harvest field from Cambodia, Lord. We thank you for the many ministries that have been set up there, Lord, for the youth work, Lord, for the daycare center, Father. And Lord, indeed, the work is plentiful, Father. So, Lord, we just want to thank you for these, your servants. We ask for your special anointing upon their lives, for your protection upon them, upon their family, Lord, that indeed, Father, they will have the confidence and the assurance, the peace in their heart, which passes all understanding, that they will be obedient to your call until, Lord, you return, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. So, Father, we just release your blessing upon their lives, Father, even as they go out, Lord, back into the field, Father. We just want to thank you and praise you in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Would you please stand together as we close in prayer and receive God's blessing? Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to him be glory forever and ever. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. We now have the closing song.
Say to those who are fearful hearted, do not be afraid. Lord your God is strong, and with his mighty arms, when you call on his name, he will come and save. He will come and save you. He will come and save.
Brothers and and sisters, we've come to the end of our service, and so have a blessed week ahead. And don't forget, please exit on the left and right at the back of the sanctuary. Have a blessed week ahead. God bless you all.